Thanks. I'm going to be talking about decisions and how our brain transforms them into actions. So a decision is a state of mind which is aiming to produce a particular action. So let's have a look at this goalkeeper. He's got to decide with very little time and very little evidence, maybe no evidence, and he's got to make an action to dive to the left or to dive to the right. And actually, sometimes he should inhibit making any action at all and stay in the middle, because sometimes that works as well. And that's going to be important at the end of my talk. So what I want to do is just think about decisions and actions. And we should remember that decision theory, classical decision theory, has been obsessed with whether our decisions are rational or irrational. But whichever one of those they are, we still have to transform them into actions. And I'm going to think about how the brain bridges decision to action. And I just want to try and say three things about that bridge. So the first thing that I would like to say is that we can't really trust our subjective experience of our own decisions. The way we think we decide is radically different from the way the brain actually decides for us. So here's a modified version of an experiment that was done recently in Sweden, which makes this point rather nicely. The experiment's very simple. The experimenter shows two pictures of two different cars to the participant in the experiment. And the participant simply has to choose to decide which car they prefer. And they indicate that by pointing towards one of the cars. The experimenter then takes both of the pictures away and then represents the car that the person had chosen and asks them to explain their decision. Now, I'll just back up a little bit. Look at those two cars. You choose which one you want. And then you have to explain your decision. But the experimenter is a magician, and you may have noticed he's actually swapped the two cars because he has a picture of the other car, which you didn't choose, hiding in the sleeve of his jacket. So that the participant is now asked to explain why they chose the car that in fact is not the one they chose at all, but the other one. Now, the interesting point is that actually most people don't even notice that the cars have been changed. This is because all cars look the same, even the ones outside today. But moreover, the people in this experiment were very, very happy to give lots of reasons why they had chosen the car, which in fact was not the car they chose at all. So they talked about the color or the shape and why they liked it. But really, that was just a confabulation. They were retrospectively inventing an experience of their own decision, which was clearly not what their brain had originally done. So we can't trust the way we think about our own decisions. The second point that I'd like to make about the bridge between decision and action is that in our culture, we think we're free. We think that we freely decide, that there's an I somewhere in my brain which is making the decisions. And it's because that I decide freely what I do that I can control my actions, influence the world around me, and become responsible. But that's not quite right either. And I'm going to show you a simple experiment that we've done recently, which looks at this relation between free decision and the sense of control and responsibility. Very simple experiment. You see a left-pointing arrow on the screen, and you press the button with your left hand. Sometimes you see a right-pointing arrow on the screen, and you press the other button with your right hand. Really simple. This is the interesting bit. Sometimes you see a double arrow. It's up to you what you press. You're free. It can be left or right. It's completely up to you. So the person might press right, or they might press left. But the interesting point is that before the double-headed arrow, we flash up very, very briefly this little black arrow on the screen, which can either point to the right, as here, or in other cases, it can point to the left. And we call that the subliminal prime. It's only there for 16 milliseconds, and that's so quick that you don't see it. You can't see that arrow at all. But your brain can nevertheless take in the information, because if you look at what people do after they've been shown a subliminal prime pointing to the right, it turns out they're a little bit more likely to freely choose to use their right hand than their left. So it's not really that free at all, is it? Because it's actually the prime which is controlling them. It's not a total effect. It's not 100% certain. But they're more likely to choose right after a right prime and more likely to choose left after a left prime. So I think we can see that now. In this particular case, the person's going to choose right. So what this means is that we can influence people's behavior by information that they're not even conscious of. They don't see those primes at all. But we were interested in the feeling that we actually control our actions and that we're responsible for what we do, because that's the basis of our society. So we made this experiment a little bit more interesting because every time you press the button, a color flashed up on the screen. And if the critical point is that here we've got a right-pointing prime, a double-headed arrow. You choose to go right, and we're going to present the color green. In other trials, you might have a right-pointing prime, but you might resist the prime somehow and choose to go left, and then you'll get a different color. In this case, you'll get the color blue. So there's a whole set of colors flashing up on the screen, and we're interested in how people understand their control over the colors that they're causing. So we're going to ask them after every color, how much control did you think you had over the color that came on the screen when you pressed the button? And they just give a judgment in percent between zero, nothing to do with me, and 100%, it's great, I'm in control. Now, what we're interested in is what do these subliminal primes, which you don't even see, but which influence your free choice, do to your feeling of responsibility and control over what happens? So here what you have is the situation on the right of the screen where the person is resisting the prime. So we might prime them to the right, they get the double-headed arrow, but they, for some reason, decide to press with the left-hand button and they get a particular color, in this case blue. And they'll say, well, about 55% control. But now let's compare that to the case where we subliminally influence their free choice and we push them to decide the way we want. So now we're going to prime them to the right. And they might actually choose, in this case, to press with their right hand in response to the double-headed arrow, and they get a different color. And in this case, they give a higher rating of control. The difference between these two numbers looks numerically small, but it's highly reliable statistically. So the interesting point here is that although the person never sees the prime that influences their behavior, they think they're more in control of what they're doing, even though they're actually less in control. So the concept that the participants are forming, that they're controlling the colors on the screen, is really a little bit of an illusion. The point where they feel most in control of the consequences of their actions is, in fact, the point where we, as the experimenters, are controlling them most. So don't necessarily trust the feeling that you're in control of your life, might be the message from those experiments. Now, if we look at the human brain, we can do now with MRI decision-making experiments and experiments where people decide which of several actions to make in a brain scanner. And I just want to give you a very quick flavor of the way these data work. You don't find a single decision center. You don't find a single sort of eye or homunculus in the brain. You don't even find separate decision centers for food and clothes and investments. No, it doesn't seem as though there are separate decision centers like that. Rather, you find separate areas which are concerned with different aspects or different dimensions of the decision. So here in green, you have an area in the frontal part of the brain which is concerned with this, what we call what decisions, deciding between two alternative actions which have equal value. So for example, in the experiments that I showed you, the very simple choice of whether to press with your left hand or your right hand involves that particular area. But if I tell you exactly what you have to do, but then leave it up to you when you do it, then you find a different area, which is the area shown here in red, which is deciding when to make a particular action. Now, this is really crucial because you all know that there are lots of actions which are appropriate in one situation, but totally inappropriate in another. So knowing when to make the action, even after you've decided to make it, is often essential. And I just want to leave you with one little final thought, which we call the weather decision. Sometimes it's extremely important to have the capacity to develop a plan of action, to get almost to the point of acting, and then stop, like the goalie, staying in the middle, which sometimes works. Most of us have had the experience of writing an email, an angry email to our boss is a quite common one. Why did I not get a pay rise? You're about to click the send button, and you hear a little voice saying, Patrick, do you really want to send that? And the answer is no, don't send it. Now, there is no little voice in the head, but what there is the capacity to hold back an action at the last moment. There's a point of no return. And the area that's shown in blue there seems to be the area which makes the final decision whether to commit to action or not. So it's the gatekeeper of self-control. And for social animals like humans, who are very, very flexible in what they can do, in what actions they can make, but whose actions have wide social impact on other people, this ability to simulate an action and say, do I really want to do that, and then possibly hold back, is absolutely fundamental. And I think that's one of the reasons why we're able to sustain in our society ideas like legal responsibility for what we do. It's because the brain offers us the capacity to hold back when it becomes inappropriate. Thanks very much.